Well, good morning, beloved. We gather this morning to celebrate the life of Margaret Hunter. In these moments together, we gather in the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, release our anger, face our emptiness, and know that God cares. We gather here as God's people, conscious of others who have died, and of the frailty of our own existence on this earth. We come to comfort and to support one another in our common loss. We gather to hear God's word of hope that can drive away our despair and move us to offer God our praise. We gather to commend to God with thanksgiving the life of Margaret Hunter as we celebrate the good news of Christ. For whether we live or whether we die, we belong to Christ, who is ruler both of the dead and of the living. Let us pray. Holy God, whose ways are not our ways, and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, grant that your Holy Spirit may intercede for us with sighs too deep for human words. Heal our wounded hearts made heavy by our sorrow. Through the veil of our tears and the silence of our emptiness, assure us again that ear has not heard, nor eye seen, nor human imagination envisioned what you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Amen. Please stand as you are able, and we will sing together, How Great Thou Art.
Thank you.
You may be seated. We will now hear the reading of Scripture by members of Margaret's family. Would our readers please come forward?
Ecclesiastes 3, 1 to 8. For everything there is a season. Excuse me. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. And a time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to sew. A time to keep silent, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time for war, and a time for peace. Here ends the reading.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. God makes me lie down in green pastures. God leads me beside still waters. God restores my soul. God leads me in right paths for God's name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of God my whole life long.
A reading from 2 Corinthians. We know that the one who raised Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and will present us with you in his presence. Indeed, everything is for your sake, so that grace, when it has extended to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart. Even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For our slight, momentarily affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, Because we look not at what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal.
It is my great honor to offer a few words about Margaret in the context of the divine word and wisdom to us this morning. And although I never had the pleasure of meeting her, I've heard stories and snippets from her, from you, her loving family. And so I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts will be pleasing to God. As our scripture from Ecclesiastes notes, there is a time for everything. There's a time to be born and a time to die. And we give thanks that Margaret lived a long life. We also give thanks that she knew when it was time for what. Time to complete her education. Time to help others as a social worker. Time to play with family at St. Simon's Island in Georgia. Time to travel back to England to maintain family connections. And time to take early retirement so she could travel the world. Margaret seemed to take the time she needed, when she needed it, to respond appropriately to the needs of those around her, and to prioritize what really mattered. This is a great gift and a sign of wisdom, to know not only what to do, but when to do it. There is a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. What an honor it will be for those of you who knew Margaret, or perhaps you knew her as Aunt Moke, to continue in her wisdom, in her skillful living, knowing when the time is right. Psalm 23 is another of our scriptures for this morning, a famous one because it comforts us in times of need, grief, or worry. This psalm extols the Holy One for being our shepherd, guiding us to green pastures and still waters, leading us in paths that will take us where we need to go. With Margaret, we thank God that when we don't know what to do or where to go, when we lack wisdom or we feel unmoored, when we find that our world is coming undone, we can look to divine love to hold us together, to lead us, and to comfort us. It is indeed a comfort to sing those words, "How great thou art." When we consider all the worlds God has made, the stars and the rolling thunder, the power throughout the universe displayed, no doubt we want to sing, "How great thou art." And in times of need, in times of worry and grief, not only is it the great creative power of God that inspires us, it is perhaps even more so the almighty love of God that holds us close. The Holy One, we know, is not primarily known to us as a distant and transcendent God in front of whom we must always bow. But our God is known to us as one who is nearer than our very breath, who is with us in the person of Jesus of Nazareth, and in communities that carry on his spirit even to the present day. And what does this God offer but to shepherd us through our days, through our nights, from England to Philadelphia, from economics to social work, from quiet days of cooking, knitting, and reading, to the excitement of tennis, the Philadelphia Orchestra, and traveling the world. God was with Margaret through it all, and God is also with us. Our final scripture comes from 2 Corinthians. It talks about divine power to raise Jesus and to raise us to be in God's presence. This scripture reminds us that although as we age, our bodies might waste away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. What this text reminds us of is that death is not final for us in God. The power of divine love and wisdom extends beyond our passing away. We are indeed embraced in God's heart eternally. For God's grace, which opens our eyes and relieves our fears in life, God's grace, which gives us hope and shields us as long as life endures, God's grace, which has no end, embraces us and embraces Margaret eternally. Divine wisdom guides us to know what is the appropriate time for what we must do. Divine love goes with us to comfort us in difficult times and to rejoice with us in peaceful and joyful times, accompanying us always. And divine power overcomes the fear of death, assuring us that we are embraced in the divine heart of grace. This is our faith. This is our trust. This is our blessed assurance for Margaret and for all who are present here. Amen. Let us now stand as we are able and sing together Amazing Grace. Be seated. We now have a few minutes for family members to share remembrances of Margaret's life. Andrew and Chris, would you please come forward to share?
Thank you, Pastor Shelley. As I was pulling together my thoughts to speak to all of you this morning, I thought about how I could sum up the life of anyone, let alone a person like Margaret, Maggie, Onimoke. In family, we always called her Onimoke, as those of us who are her nieces and nephews, and so I know I will refer to her that way no matter how hard I try to pick another name, and she was all of those names. In fact, and I despaired of the ability or my ability to sum up her life or to connect that to, you know, a broader meaning for all of us. So thank you, because you did that. You did that beautifully. Probably one of my main conclusions when I think about my relationship with Ani Mok and about her life, as I understood it, was that she was truly an individual. You often think of people in terms of who they're like, and you can connect them. And maybe if you were relating them to another person, you would say, well, they're like this character in a movie, or they're like this other person that someone may know, a mutual acquaintance. And I honestly cannot think of anyone that I could compare Ani Mok to and say, she's just like that person. She was truly a unique person in wonderful ways. And for me, because she was there throughout my life, growing and finding my own way to being an adult, to being a husband, to being a father, there was great comfort in knowing that you could forge your own path. And I think she set an amazing example of that. I also have always understood from the earliest days that being English was a core part of her identity, you know, and over the years, I don't know that we ever had any kind of an extended conversation, but she always chose to remain an English citizen, never, despite 60 years in the United States, as a resident alien, decided to become an American citizen. It's just who she was. There was not a reason. It wasn't that she didn't want to be an American citizen per se. It's just that she was English. That was her. And so many of my memories are tied to that aspect of her. And I think it really always captured for me a part of my own identity, that there was always that connection. I mean, I grew up and lived my entire life in the United States, but always felt that connection to England. Now, it was always a core part of my father's identity as well, her brother, Chris. And he was the English professor, right? If you went to visit him at his office at Florida State, he had a placard on the door that said, everything sounds a little more intelligent when spoken with a British accent. And that was definitely part of his identity and his accent, even though when he went back to England, he was always told that he had an American accent now. In the context of Florida, he sounded very English, very British, and that was always part of his identity. But for Ani Mok, it was even more so. It was even more true that she was just English to her core. And since I'm not able to really summarize her life or the broader meaning of it, I will just give you some memories. That's ultimately what I decided was what I wanted to do. And as a child, obviously, the thing that you remember about a relative is kind of, you know, when you see them, it's usually at a holiday and there's gifts involved. But there was always so much excitement about Ani Mok coming to visit. She was a wonderful personality. She was very loving. She always brought Smarties from England, which was a treat that we absolutely delighted in, and I still have to procure every time that I'm in the United Kingdom. I don't know too many people in the United Kingdom who seem to fixate on them the way that we do in our family. But I find a way, and they are that. Fortunately, it is still not that hard to procure Smarties in the UK. It always seemed that somehow every gathering that we had, she had just been to the United Kingdom. She had just been to visit England, and so there were always Smarties. I don't know how she managed that. There was some magic there. You know, she was a champion knitter. I think one of the disadvantages of having all your nieces and nephews live in Florida is there is not a high demand for big wool sweaters. But she did sometimes knit us, you know, warm things, but and then knitted things for our, you know, our stuffed animals, and found other ways to bring that talent to be something that could be a gift to us. And it was a fabulous way for her to occupy her time. I spent a lot of time with Ani Mok when I was in college. I went to college in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and would always go down to Philadelphia if I had, you know, like a weekend. Not enough time, maybe, at least by the standards of the 1990s, maybe not enough time to go back to Florida, but enough time to leave town. And so I would go to Philadelphia. I would take the train to Philadelphia. And I know I will never be able to walk into 30th Street Station without thinking of her. I may be one of the only people who has fond associations with 30th Street Station, but although it's a magnificent building, but that is, you know, that was always that excitement. I'd come off the train and she would be there waiting for me, and we'd go up the Schuylkill Expressway up to her house in Ardmore. She made those weekends all about me, which was another great gift. You know, when you're in college and you're away from home, you're just sort of one of the masses, and you, and when you're home with family, of course, I'm one of four children, so as loving as all that was, you know, the visits with Auntie Moke were the time when it was suddenly all about me, which is nice. She put a lot of effort into it, and, you know, she would cook the things that I liked, and bangers and mash. And I was in college, and I was on the crew team, so I ate a lot, and you would not believe how many bangers and mash I could eat in a sitting. Sometimes I couldn't believe it, and I'm sure she couldn't believe it, but she always had enough. She always had made whatever ungodly amount I was going to eat. She had made it and had prepared for it, had planned for it. She had always would get the Beaujolais Nouveau. You know, Thanksgiving was kind of the season where Beaujolais Nouveau was available. She would have a case or two that she had procured. I didn't drink that much, but it was wonderful. It was a special, you know, special thing about going to visit her. We would go to the Bowerses for Thanksgiving itself, and it was amazing to see that, you know, in addition to our family, she had become part of others' families, and specifically, especially the Bowers family. And those were wonderful visits, and wonderful to be able to be with a big family, even if it wasn't directly my big family. I was a semi-adopted member for a number of years. And then we would have special visits around the area of Philadelphia, and especially the Longwood Gardens, I remember often. After I graduated from college and moved to D.C., we spent a lot of time together traveling. She loved to travel. She was a very practiced and skilled traveler. And she and I would take long car trips. We would drive down to St. Simon's Island, which is about it was a 10-hour drive from D.C. For her, it would be another, you know, 2.5 from Philadelphia to pick me up, which she would often do. And then we would drive down, we would drive back, we would drive to Birmingham or Nashville to visit with Rosemary and her family. And there was one memorable occasion where Rosemary even left her children in our care for several days, a miracle of trust and confidence. That Auntie Moke and I would do together. We were a team. And I will say that there's not a lot of people in this world that you can be on a 10-hour car ride with and just be comfortable the whole time. You know, those long car rides can be awkward. And what is there to say by hour 8, 9? But it was always wonderful. You know, we could talk or we could not talk and be equally comfortable in either scenario. And I got a lot of mentoring and wisdom from her on those trips about my life and my career, and got to learn about her life and what mattered to her. And Christmas, she would bring the Christmas crackers, and often from England. Always that connection to family back in England. Later, when I had my own family and was married, and we would go up to Philadelphia with the children and visit her in Philadelphia and go to the Franklin Institute and just enjoy the city of Philadelphia. So many wonderful memories. And being a Philadelphian was core to her identity. It was just part of her, part of how I thought of her, and part of how I always remember her is with the city of Philadelphia. And every part of it that I've been to makes me think of her. She did eventually come join us in Virginia when that really was kind of the only alternative. The level of care that she needed meant that it was better to be here than there. But I know her group of friends that she always made effort and great effort to spend time with and interact with and go to orchestra concerts with and other, you know, events and time on the Jersey Shore and very important to her. So that's my main memory that I want to leave you with, is to think of her as a completely unique English woman who lived in Philadelphia for the vast majority of her life, who had tremendous friends that she endlessly enjoyed spending time with and keeping in touch with, engaging with, caring for when necessary, and enjoying the company of at all times. And then her tremendous dedication to family. Our family always felt like she would do anything for us. And I know that is a feature of her relationship with almost the entire family, if not the entire family. Thank you.
Andrew's talk has certainly wakened some memories in my mind. I brought those Smarties back a couple of times. And one year, I was entrusted with bringing back the bear. The Harrods bear. I forget whose bear it was. But I brought back the bear, and when I got back to Philadelphia, I called and I said, the bear has landed. You know, each of us has many faces that we share to people, that we share to the world. And a lot of times, we attach names to those faces and personas. For example, Maggie, Auntie Moke, Margaret, and probably at one time, Miss Hunter. But to me, she was Maggie, of course. When the family asked me to speak, I think they were hoping that I would be able to talk about her life in Philadelphia. And that's partially true. There were a lot of things we actually didn't share. I didn't play bridge or tennis. I'm not a fan of the Jersey Shore or outlet shopping, and I have no special affection for cats. But we had a very long friendship, you know, almost, well, more than 50 years. That's a long time. I've known Maggie longer than Andrew has. Though our friendship started as social workers at the Hospital of the University of Pennsylvania, and we worked side by side in Cambridge, our professional lives developed separately. I left social work while she advanced in that field. Her professional achievements were important to her, and in becoming director of social work at Thomas Jefferson University Hospital, she joined the ranks of notable social work leaders in a city known for its medical education and healthcare services. However, I would like to focus on the role that Maggie played in my life in other ways. She was a connector, an enabler, and an instigator. These last in the best senses of the words. When I met Maggie in 1971, I was a newly minted MSW and establishing a new life in Philadelphia. Almost immediately, she drew me into her network of friends, many of whom she had met through the Trinity Club, a group based at Holy Trinity Church in Rittenhouse Square. By spring of 1973, Maggie had moved back to England. And when I went to visit her, she introduced me to someone with whom she worked at the University College Hospital in London, and who, 50 years on, is one of my dearest friends. That was Maggie as a connector. As an enabler, she also paved the way for me to have a job interview at Cambridge County Council Social Services. This was a turning point in my life, one that would not have happened except for Maggie. She not only helped me get a job, but knowing that she was there, knowing that she would support me, gave me the courage to live and work in England. Though my working life there was short, living and working in another country gave me a different worldview, and again, introduced me to many people who became friends. We were both back in Philadelphia by winter of 1975, and from that time on, we shared many activities. I have referred to Maggie as my social secretary, because she was usually the one who invited me to various events. The orchestra is doing this, and I think we ought to go, or, you know, things like that. She kept me very busy. This was Maggie at her best as an instigator. We hosted and attended parties. We traveled, road trips in the U.S. and U.K., as well as more exotic trips to a farmhouse in Tuscany, Australia, New Zealand, Fiji, and India. She was braver than I and went to Tibet, Antarctica, and other places without me. We went to the opera and, of course, to the Philadelphia Orchestra concerts. It was Maggie who enlisted me as a volunteer at the orchestra. I think of her often when I go to concerts now, and I look at the musicians on the stage and think, ah, yes, that's someone Maggie knew. Or I can remember she had a timpani lesson with Don Liuzzi. As Andrew mentioned, Maggie became part of my family, sharing many Thanksgiving, Easter, and toward the end of her time in Philadelphia, Christmas dinners with us. Any long friendship has its dark moments. Deaths, illness, personal disappointments. True friends support one another in the best way they can in these times, as she did when I was ill. Maggie's life became more constricted after she had a stroke. She was no longer the instigator. Things we did together were usually proposed and planned by me. I was never as good at it as she had been. Shortly after Maggie moved to Virginia, I came to visit her. Her mind had begun to cloud, and it was difficult to hold a conversation. That was the last time I saw her, and I suppose, in a way, that was when I said goodbye. I am sad and feel a bit guilty about that, but I am comforted by the knowledge that Andrew, Karen, Allison, and the children were on hand to give her the love, care, and attention she needed and deserved. And I have the good fortune of being able to remember her as bright and active and full of life. Without a doubt, Maggie was one of the people who shaped my life, introducing me to good friends and helping me expand my horizons, as she may have done for some of you. And I am grateful to have known her.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you, Chris. As we gather our hearts, let us again say what we believe. We believe there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we know that in everything, God works for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. We are sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. God, our strength and our Redeemer, giver of life and conqueror of the fear of death, we praise you with humble hearts. With faith in your great mercy and wisdom, we entrust Margaret to your eternal care. We praise you for your steadfast love for her in all the days of her earthly life. We thank you for all that she was to those who loved her and for her faithfulness to the Church of Jesus Christ. God, we thank you that for Margaret all sickness and sorrow are ended and death itself is past, and that she has entered the home where all your people gather in peace. Keep us all in communion with your faithful people in every time and place, that at last we may rejoice together in the heavenly family where Jesus Christ reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever. Amen. And now let us pray the prayer of our Savior. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful one, we commend your servant, Margaret Hunter. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a daughter of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of eternal peace, and into the company of the saints in light. Amen. Please join in reciting the Song of Simeon. Holy One, now let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal you to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Please stand as you are able and let us sing. Thank you. And now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated for the postlude. And after the postlude, we are invited to talk with anyone who's online today before you go out to the social hall for some refreshments.